As close as y'all came against Alabama last year, leading in the fourth quarter, how much different, if at all, is your confidence level going into this year's game with Alabama versus maybe previous times y'all have played them?
I think in the previous years, we didn't really know how we'd do against the premier SEC teams, but now we see ourselves as one of the premier SEC teams. And with that being said, we know we can play with anybody. We went head-to-head, squared up with top 10 team Texas A&M down in Texas at College Station. So with that being said, having the game in Neyland Stadium and playing the number one team in the country, we have a lot of confidence. And if we play our style of football, then we know we'll always have a chance of winning the ball game.
Todd, Coach Jones was talking to yesterday in terms of like tackling and missed tackles. John brought it up. He was saying in practice sometimes it's hard to replicate that. Do you feel like you guys get enough tackling practice, or do you feel that's something that's kind of you wish you had more opportunities to kind of refine that technique?
I really wish we did have the opportunity to refine that technique. However, with injuries on a team, and you know it's in the middle of the season, and you have to try to cut the reps down as much as possible because you have to have your body ready for Saturday. And with that being said, they try to do whatever we can in drills to simulate what's going to go on and what's going to happen on Saturday. But to be honest, you can't really simulate what's going to happen when you're squaring off for 60 minutes. Something's going to happen that you didn't practice. And with that being said, you know, you're just going to have to use the techniques that you've always been taught. And we're going to really focus on tackling this week because they do a great job of breaking tackles. They have a lot of speed guys out there that can move their feet and get after it. So we're going to really focus on the tackling aspect this week.
Todd, I know that Texas A&M is an explosive offense, but I think you guys gave up 10 plays of 20 yards or more. What do you guys have to do defensively to limit the big play issues that you guys have kind of dealt with for the first half of the season?
Well, no question. They had a lot of explosive plays, and explosive plays get you beat, or they allow you to win if you're on the offensive side of the ball. Because I'm a defensive player, we try to eliminate explosive plays. And Coach Shoup laid it out to us. I want to say there was 9 plays that accounted for over 300 yards. And if you took away those plays, it would have looked like we played phenomenal football. But adding those 9 plays to the equation kind of skewed the data and allowed them to have so many yards. So we're going to focus on eliminating explosive plays and just tackling in open space and making sure the ball doesn't get thrown over our heads. And if we do that, then we compete with anybody.
TK, you've been around here a long time. What's the Alabama series mean to you? And also, have you ever met Lane Kiffin? If so, when and where?
Yeah, I met Coach Kiffin during the recruiting days. And when I came over to the complex, I used to see him. I used to just say hello to him. I didn't really know him on a personal level. I really knew his father more than really him, just because of the defense side of the ball. But Coach Kiffin's a great guy, really smart. He knows how to execute on the opposite side of the ball. He tries to really scheme you up and match up the man on man, the guy that they have trust in, and match up a guy that they really think they can execute and beat. With that being said, you know, he really does a great job of scheming. But I don't really know him on a personal level. I just know he's a great coach.
In the Alabama series?
In terms of the Alabama series, it's very important to the Tennessee football family. Growing up in Knoxville, I've always known as Alabama as one of our rivals. And that, you know, the last couple of years, they've beat us. And I don't know if they consider us a rival, but I know we sure consider them a rival. And with that being said, every year I go into it and make sure that we go in 100% ready to play the ball game.
DK, you kind of touched on the ball getting thrown over. You guys said, as safeties, what can you guys do to kind of help the corners in those situations? Or is it more of a whole defensive effort to kind of give those guys some a little bit more relief?
I think it starts with everyone, not just the safeties. You know, you have 11 people on the field functioning as one. And as much as the corners get picked on, you know, the safeties have to do a better job of helping them when we have the opportunity to. But you can't run the same coverage every play because there's coverage beaters. So you have to try to mix it up. And when we do, we have to trust that the guys out there are going to be able to make plays and execute for us. So when our name is called and the coverage is called, it's our duty to be over the top or in the middle of the field like we're supposed to be.
I know he's on the other side of the ball, but with Alvin kind of playing his former team again this year, I was just wondering, what kind of respect does he command from the team as a whole, and how has he kind of shown his leadership either on or off the field as one of the captains?
I think he goes into it with the same mentality as every other game, which is to lead the offense, lead the team, and just to have confidence within us as well as himself. And the game that he had this past week really emphasizes how much work he's put in and how much he trusts the program and the overall offense, and that when his opportunity was called, that he was able to make plays for our team. But in terms of just looking at the Alabama game, I know it's important to him as much as he doesn't want to say it. But at the same time, he realizes that it's just the next game and we have to get this victory.
Hey, TK, in talking about protecting against the deep ball and it getting thrown over your head, how do you balance being mindful of not having it thrown over your head versus keeping that aggressiveness and kind of that ball-hawking mentality that you have?
Well, I think Coach Shoup helps a lot with that, with the play calling. I know when he's going to be aggressive, when he's going to fall back a little bit and be conservative. And with that being said, when you step on the football field, you have to come out with the aggressive mindset, especially in the SEC, or else you know you're going to get it given to you, really. So with that being said, no matter what the play is called, I'm going to go out with the mentality of making a play, every play for my teammates. And I know that the other 10 guys out there with me have that same mentality. And we all have that same mentality, and we're on the same page. That's when we execute the best, I think.
TK, in the back here, as a veteran on defense, you know, what was kind of your reaction yesterday to the Danny O'Brien news? And how do you guys kind of fill that leadership void? Obviously, he was kind of a vocal guy in the locker room for you guys. Who's gonna kind of step into that role?
Well, Danny's a great guy, first off. And the years that I got to spend with him were amazing. He was a great mentor for me. And I really had no clue. I saw on social media, that's how I found out. And so I wasn't really sure what went down. And I know his phone was blowing up and stuff like that probably, so I didn't text him or ask what happened or anything like that. So I was kind of perplexed when I heard the news. But we're really gonna miss Danny. You know, he was a great attribute to our team. But at the same time, it's gonna allow other people to step up. And when you have a void, you have to fix it. And even though he was a piece to our puzzle, I feel like we'll be able to fill that piece again. And he's a great guy, and I wish him the best in the future.
Yeah, I think your sister either was or is a cheerleader at Alabama. I guess what's this week like for you and your family? Both sides of the rivalry, I guess.
Yeah, I actually brought her here. She's going to meet me later, like in the complex, just to talk about the Alabama-Tennessee game. But it's pretty special. It's a house divided, definitely. Even though it's 3-1, Tennessee-Alabama, it still has a little division going on. And she makes sure that even though she's the only one that we hear Roll Tide every now and then. But she supports me in any way she possibly can. She lives in Knoxville now, so she tries to come to all my games when she can if she doesn't have work. And this year, you know, she really told me that, hey, you know, you're a veteran now and you actually have a say in this game, and I'm really proud of you, just for her being a cheerleader down there cheering for the team. And now that she has to cheer for her brother as well, even though I'm going against her alma mater, I think it's kind of exciting for her because she gets to go for both teams, for the Volunteers and Alabama. So with that being said, I think it's pretty cool. And I can't speak for herself, but hopefully she cheers for her brother a little more.
TK, have you had the chance to kind of look over the roster when you're, you know, on the back end of the defense and you look and there's no JRM, there's no Sutton? What is it like when you think that you guys are still in these competitive games, but now even more so with Danny out, that you guys are down 5 or 6 starters at times?
It amazes me, and it's something that I never would have guessed or hypothesized at the beginning of the year. But problems always come your way. You know, trials and tribulations may happen, but at the same time, you have to find ways to get around it. It's almost like an obstacle course. You can still get to the finish line even though there's obstacles. You just have to make a plan and task it out and make it happen. And I feel like that's what this team is doing. And we're having a lot of people step up and make plays for us. And there's a lot of role players on our team, guys that fill particular roles on this team, and they're trying to execute to the utmost that they can. And I feel like if they do that, then we're going to be able to stick together.
Just housekeeping. What's your sister's name? And did she just graduate last year? Was she a cheerleader during last year's game? Or?
She graduated 2 years ago, so not like this past year, but the year before. And her name is Clark, C-L-A-R-K-E, Kelly.
So she never had to cheer against
you? No, she cheered at the home games. And so my freshman year, it was an away game. Wait, no, that doesn't make sense. Well, it was away game for her, home game for us. Yeah, yeah. So.
Hey, TK, you could talk about the guys just continuing to step up in different positions, but do you sense that, I guess, Shai and Khalil and maybe even Tongbo and some of those guys are ready to step up in Danny's absence?
I really think they are. It's a great opportunity for all three of them. And I believe that from watching film, Shai and Khalil play a little bit more than Jonathan did, but they had one of their best games of their career playing against Texas A&M. And that gives me confidence, as well as them, as well as the coaching staff and the rest of my teammates. And they know what they're called to do. When they're recruited here, they know what they signed up for. I think that now that the opportunity is here, that they have to do what they can and run with it. And I feel like they're capable of doing so.
Hey, TK, just looking at the film, what stands out about Bama's quarterback? Does he look like a freshman on tape, or does he look like a guy that has been there for a little bit and plays with some more experience?
I feel like Jalen Hurts is very athletic. He can do it all. Real calm in the pocket. Never really gets too flustered. And that's big time for a freshman, because when you have a freshman back there, you know, they can sometimes get flustered or not trust the O-line. But he trusts his O-linemen, trusts his receivers, tight ends, and running backs to block for him. And he is an offensive threat. You know, that he brings that spread package to them now, which normally they were kind of balanced or conservative with the running pass, but now they can do it all in terms of formations, and that brings another dimension to their offense. So he's very challenging. He's going to bring a lot of problems to our defense.
Along the lines of their offense, talk a little bit about their receiving core, and not just the receivers, but their tight end, O.J. Howard.
Well, yeah, they have some good receivers and a good tight end, O.J. Howard. They have really a lot of good tight ends, but O.J. Howard is their main receiver, and he can do it all. Big, fast, can catch, can block. Calvin Ridley, everybody knows who he is, our Darius Stewart. So they have some playmakers on the offensive side of the ball, and our job as a defensive backfield is to just eliminate the big players, like I talked about before, because they're one explosive play away from blowing the game away. My freshman year, Amari Cooper had an 80-yard catch, and those guys have the same capabilities of doing the same thing.
Appreciate it.
Just wondering, as close as y'all came against Alabama last year leading in the fourth quarter, I'm just wondering if y'all's confidence level going into this game with Alabama is any different than it's been previous years, just to believe that y'all can win this game.
I mean, every time we step on the field, you know, we have belief that we can win the game. You know, we just know we have to go out and play our you know, style of play, and, you know, execute. And, you know, we always have belief we can win the game when we step on the field.
Josh, have you thought about how explosive this offense could be if you eliminated the turnovers and penalties?
I mean, we saw how explosive we could be, you know, putting up 700 yards of offense, you know, last game. But obviously, you know, the turnovers, you know, slowed us down in scoring points. So, you know, we see that, you know, as long as we execute and we don't hurt ourselves, don't shoot ourselves in the foot, we can, you know, move the ball and do what we want to do on offense. But we have to continue to execute and protect the football, of course, better than we did last game.
Josh, what have you seen from Tyler Byrd, and just how much has he grown in the course of, I guess, the first six games?
Mm-hmm. He continues to grow each game. You know, just getting him the ball, different looks, getting him into space. You know, he always makes the first guy miss, it seems like. So, you know, there's a big, big, you know, part of our offense, you know, just getting him the ball in space along with the other receivers. But, you know, it's definitely great to have him as an addition.
Josh, can you kind of put into perspective at all, like, your growth as a player and the growth of this program since you ran out onto the field against Alabama and kind of took over the offense a couple years ago in the stadium?
Yeah, you know, it's definitely has grown a lot. It's been a lot of, you know, change and a lot of positive growth, you know, as a program. Obviously, you know, we see it with the results, and, you know, our goal is to continue to grow, continue to improve. You know, yeah, it's, you know, it's crazy to look back at how far we've come in, you know, just 2 years, and we definitely can continue to improve moving forward.
Kind of following up on that, Josh, your freshman year, you guys went down there and lost by 35, and now 3 years later, it's a top 10 game. I guess, can you just kind of speak to where Alabama's clearly been, you know, the top college football, but can you just kind of, is it kind of amazing how far you guys have come and kind of narrowed that gap a little bit?
Yeah, it's what we expected to do when we came here. You know, like guys like me, Jalen, Cam, when we committed, and that was the goal, getting Tennessee back to where it should be. You know, we're top 10, and we feel like, you know, we definitely can play a lot better, and we can continue to grow and continue to improve as a team. So it's definitely great to see the strides that we've made over, you know, the time that we've been here. And now, you know, our mindset is we want to still finish strong.
What are some of the things this coaching staff has done to kind of emphasize and put in practice off the field, on the field, in the meeting room, just emphasize the importance of taking care of the ball, ball protection, avoiding turnovers?
You know, we know the importance of taking care of the football. Now, as you know, it's just putting us in situations throughout practice where, you know, our mind, where we're running or, you know, throwing, or our mind's not on protecting the football, but we still have to make sure that we have proper form in, you know, chinning the ball or in the throw game and various things. So, you know, it's just different things throughout practice, focusing in on the details that will help us in the game.
Josh, way over here. You've played against Alabama a couple of times now. You're scouting, you know, watching video of this particular defense. Defensively speaking, are they at another level in general? If so, what makes them so good on defense?
Yeah, you know, they're physical up front. You know, obviously, you know, their size and physicality on the defensive line. And then, you know, just their discipline and their fundamentals. And, you know, you know, every year you come into it, and it's one of the most disciplined teams you're going to play. So if you're going to go out and compete with them, you have to have discipline on offense. You have to have discipline in execution, discipline in your schemes. You know, the little details are what separate the difference between winning and losing in games like this. So you have to be focused and locked in throughout practice.
The fact that you gained almost 700 yards against A&M, does that give you a lot of confidence going into the Alabama game, even as good as Alabama's defense is?
I mean, as I've said, we've always had confidence. So confidence has never been, you know, the issue going into a game. You know, the issue is we just have to play our game and execute, and we know how good we can be. I would say, you know, the thing it just does is just reassure, you know, the type of offense we can be, as long as we're focusing in on the details and executing throughout the game.
Josh, when you play a guy like Minkah Fitzpatrick, you had 3 interceptions last week. Is that a guy you have to check where he is on the field? Do you have to be more conscious of someone like that?
You know, a little bit. You have to understand, you know, your matchups, who they have on who we have. You know, various things go into it. So, you know, you just have to be locked into the looks that you're getting by the defense. You know, I know he moves around. He plays a little nickel, plays corner as well. So he moves around a little bit. So just be focused and locked in on the matchups that we have on the perimeter.
Just wondering, I'm not saying Alvin had a huge game last week, but I'm just wondering what kind of respect does he command, whether in the locker room, the meeting room, that type of thing, and how has he kind of shown his leadership since he's been here?
Yeah, and I think, you know, since the day he stepped on campus, you know, guys have respected him. You know, most of us, you know, played against him or knew of him in high school. I've obviously known Alvin for a while, so we know what type of player he is and the type of person he is as well. You know, so he definitely has a lot of control when he speaks to guys. Guys listen, and you know, he continues to push guys every time he comes in the building. So he's definitely a big piece of our team.
Josh, Alabama's got a different defensive coordinator this year. Do you see any difference in their defense from the previous years, or does it look the same because basically it's Nick Saban's defense?
There's some similarities. Obviously, with a new D coordinator, they have some different sprinkles that they'll sprinkle in with different pressures, different looks. But it's definitely, you know, similar stuff to as we've seen, but you have to still be prepared for the wrinkles and just understanding the personality of a new defensive coordinator. You have to be ready for any wrinkles that you could get, understanding that.
Hey Josh, I wondered if you could speak to Jack Jones and Chance Hall, just maybe what they bring on the right side of the line, and particularly with Chance having missed, you know, half or more of preseason camp, and it seems like he's come back in and not really missed a beat.
Yeah, you know, they just bring consistency. That's what they've shown. They showed it last year when they stepped in, you know, both as freshmen coming in and playing a huge role throughout the middle of the season to finish off the season and then to continue to play at a high level throughout the beginning of the season. So, you know, that's a great testament to them. You know, obviously their work ethic that they put in, you know, just starting on Sundays, in O-line meetings, player-led meetings, watching film and everything, and then throughout the week, working on their fundamentals, their hand placement, the details, and it's been helping them out on Saturday. So they'll continue to grow as they've had, but they've definitely been a great part of our O-line.
Josh, I'm sure you guys are probably tiring of all the turnover questions, but it seems like a few of them on Saturday came when guys were trying to fight for extra yards or kind of make a play. How do you guys as players kind of balance trying to, you know, make a play or make something happen versus making sure that you take care of the ball and don't turn it over?
Yeah, you got to be smart, understand the situation. You just, when you're straining and trying to get extra yards, you still have to secure the ball. Still have to have good fundamentals, good technique in securing the ball so it doesn't get poked out. So, you know, that's the key emphasis, and that's what we've been focusing on in practice, and that's what we'll focus on throughout the week.
Josh, there were a couple times on those final couple drives at A&M in regulation where you didn't hesitate to go to Tyler Byrd. You know, you threw the ball to Brandon Johnson for, I think, the first catch of his career in a spot like that. What made you confident to go to those guys in those situations when obviously the game's on the line?
Just, you know, their practice habits. You know, we put them in pressure situations throughout practice and throughout fall camp, and they responded well. They came in and made catches in those situations, so I had 100% confidence that they would in a game. You know, I talked to them just throughout the game. I've been talking to Brandon that, you know, when your number's called and your time comes, you got to be ready to step up and make a play. You know, and he did that. You know, he had a couple big catches that helped us progress and move down the field. So, you know, they understand that. They understand, you know, that, you know, the expectations when they come in the game that, you know, the ball's going to be coming their way and they're going to have to make a play. So, there's no excuses if they don't, and they definitely responded well, which was great to see.
Josh, TK mentioned that he found out about Danielle Bryan's dismissal from social media. Just how did you find out, and what was your reaction? I mean, it seemed kind of sudden for you guys after what he went through Saturday.
Yeah, it was a little sudden. But, you know, we definitely, you know, wish him the best. I know, you know, he sent out a tweet, a message about it and everything, and we definitely wish him the best. You know, obviously, OB's been here since, you know, I got here. You know, this is his fifth year here and everything, so I'm sorry to see him go out that way for sure, but we definitely wish him the best. And, you know, in my every interaction that I have with OB has always been awesome, positive, pushing this team, pushing different guys, pushing the D-line to continue to work hard and grind and get where we want to be. And, you know, he and that's really has helped us grow for sure.
Josh, I think you proved yourself early in your career who's not going to get fazed by a big situation or playing against a tough team. And did you go into the season knowing that the guys around you felt the same way, or did you think that maybe y'all would need to win a big game or two before everybody else started to believe?
I think I went into the season, you know, understanding that we've, especially, you know, from the team last year who played in several big games, and, you know, we obviously know what happened last year, but that this team, you know, understood, you know, how to play in big games, and understood, you know, just the, you know, the pressure and the intensity that comes along with playing a big game. And, you know, this year our key was, you know, to finish out those teams strong, which we have. So it wasn't really, I guess, a confidence issue. It was just, you know, if we go out, we play four quarters of football, then we'll be able to finish. And that's what this team has done thus far, and we'll need to continue to do that.
Josh, do you think Alabama has a great defense more because of personnel, more because of scheme, or is it just a combination of two?
I think it's a combination of both. You know, obviously Nick Saban and their coaching staff, you know, their names just speak for themselves. And when you combine that with, you know, physical guys who are, you know, fundamentally sound, then, you know, it's kind of the, I guess, perfect formula for a great defense. And you know, so when you know that going into the game, you know you're playing that, you know that you're going to have to just focus, lock in on your details, lock in on your execution. You know, we've seen throughout the season that, you know, we've kind of been the only team that has shot our own selves in the foot throughout the season. So if we go in focusing on our execution, we have good players too that are fundamentally sound and can compete and play at a high level of football. So, you know, it should be definitely a good competition for sure.
Josh, after the game that Alvin and John Kelly had, and obviously what you can do in the ground game, and if Hurd's back, how much more difficult does it make it for a defense to prepare for four different options instead of one or two different options?
No, it's just dynamic. I know anytime a defense has to any added dimension, you know, makes it difficult on the defense. So, you know, from our eyes, you know, we have to execute to continue to make it difficult, and that's what we continue to do. But, yeah, you know, just the production was great from J.K., Alvin, and obviously having Jalen back is great. So we'll be able to use, you know, all of us along with the receiving core to have a dynamic offense on Saturday.
Thanks, Josh. Tyler, when you were recruited in January, I know you thought you were going to be a defensive back. What ended up bringing along the change from DB to offense, and how quickly did you feel like you just kind of caught on with everything on the offensive side?
Really, Coach called me and he asked me, could I play offense? And I said, whatever would help the team is what I'll do. So I just embraced the role of being a wideout instead of a defensive back in college and just ran with it.
Tyler, along those lines, did you identify yourself as more of a DB coming out? Did you always think of yourself as more of a receiver? I know a lot of guys that play both ways, you know, always like to have the ball in their hands. You know, did you kind of identify with one side of the ball more than the other?
Yeah, I think I was more of a defensive back, but now just being here and embracing the role as a wide receiver and with the great mentors of Josh Smith, Josh Malone, and Josh Dobbs, just embracing that role as a wide receiver now.
How comfortable do you feel with knowing the entire offense right now? And also, what did it mean to you for Dobbs to go to you in some clutch situations against A&M?
I feel really confident. Like I said, I got great mentors, and they make sure I know all the plays, and I'm always in just trying to get the extra work in. So I know in those times that Josh Dobbs feels confident. It's an honor that he feels confident to, you know, go to me in that situation.
Tyler, just, you know, I know you probably had expectations for what the SEC would be like, but now that you're in the middle of this four-game stretch like you guys have been, just what's it been like as a true freshman to have, you know, to be facing this kind of competition every week with this kind of national attention?
It's kind of crazy just to be put in a fire like that, and it's an honor to be in this situation. I just got to embrace my role, whatever role they give me, whether it's on special teams or offense, and just, you know, be ready to step up into that SEC spotlight and be able to contribute.
Tyler, you kind of mentioned being kind of identifying more as a defensive back. How much, you played receiver in high school, but I guess how much did you play it, and how different is it playing at that level, the position at that level as it is in the SEC?
Yeah, just being a defensive back. So now being able to – I played a little wide receiver, but not as much as I did defensive back in high school. So now being able to play here as a wide receiver is, like I said, it's just an honor. But, like, with the mentors I have, I think it made it easier to be able to just step into this role and just play in the SEC.
Thanks. Tyler, I can't remember if it was TK or Dobbs earlier who said you got a knack for always making the first guy miss. Do you feel like that's a particular gift? Is that something that you've always had?
I think it's just a gift. I mean, God-given gift to just be able to make the first person miss and get as much yards as I can. And
then following up, your relationship with Larry Scott, you know, how much did that factor into you selecting Tennessee? What was that final month or so like when you were choosing between the Vols and Miami?
Coach Scott definitely played a big role in that, and my brother who plays here. And also just that last month, it was crazy, and I just trusted my heart and just stuck with Tennessee, and I think it was a great choice.
Tyler, this has been obviously a grind the past month, and now facing a team as physical as Alabama. How do you think you and maybe the rest of the newcomers have been holding up physically? You know, is it starting to leave a mark on you, or do you feel like y'all are conditioned and okay with this?
I think we're definitely conditioned and okay with this, and we got to be more of role players now, being on special teams. I mean, we have starters now who are on a lot of special teams, and I don't think they can play many reps, so as young guys, we got to really step up and give those guys a break on the special teams so we can be better on offense and defense.
And what are your thoughts on Alabama as you've watched some film with them? And obviously everyone knows how they've recruited for years and years now and how much they've won. What do you see from them on film?
That's definitely a very physical team. They're very physically sound on defense, well-coached team. And I think we just got to come out and we got to execute the way we should. And I think we should be good.
Tyler, I think Coach back here, I think Coach Jones mentioned when you were on Vol calls a few weeks ago that you know, you could maybe play both sides of the ball. Has that been discussed at all? Is that something you would be open to doing or would like to do? Or you know, how much has that been thrown out there? Is that kind of just a joke you guys throw around sometimes?
I would definitely be open to it. I think now, right now, is really just learning the offense and being really confident in the offense. And I think when I'm really confident in the offense and able to play as fast as I can in the offense, then the defensive side would just come in.
Tyler, I know you were a track star in Florida, obviously a pretty athletic guy. When you came to Tennessee, what guys on the team jumped out at you as far as maybe having some of the same kind of freakish athleticism that you showed in high school and you've shown so far on this team?
I think Evan Berry, of course, he's our kickoff return guru. He could take it to the house at any point in time. Ahmed Kamar, he's – and Dobbs, all of them, they're really those guys who – they make the first guy miss, and that's why we block 63, and we try and strain our hardest because we never know when they're just going to break multiple tackles and try to go to the house. So it's just our job to play 63.
What did you know when you were in high school? What did you know about the Tennessee-Alabama rivalry, and what do you know about it now?
I knew about it a little bit. I didn't know how much it actually meant. Of course, my recruiting came late to the University of Tennessee, so but now I know the stage of it and how big it is and what it means, so I'm just doing my best this week to be prepared and ready to step into the light.
Tyler, we've asked you all these questions about playing receiver and playing defense back. Do you miss playing defense at all?
For sure. Being a defensive guy, I definitely miss it, but I'm just here to embrace my role as a wide receiver.
Tyler, was there a moment this season, whether it was a play in a game or in practice, when things just started to click or slow down for you, when you realized, hey, okay, I can do this?
I think that definitely happened in the Florida game. That was, of course, my first SEC game, and being able to just make a few plays, I think that really helped me, and it just clicked, and now to be able to just embrace my role.
Hey, Tyler, Coach Uzani was saying like he had to be careful when you hit that freshman wall. Do you feel like you hit that wall, or do you just go right through it and go past it, or do you feel like there was a point where you were like, you know, kind of tired this year, it's college? Any thoughts of that?
No, I don't think I've hit that wall, but it might come, and when I do, I just got to keep grinding through it because I think there's people who need me and I need them, and as a team, we just got to keep going. I think everybody, no matter whether you're a freshman or a senior, you're going to hit that wall to where you just get tired, and I think we all just need to push through it.